We're going to look at accounting for investments for equity securities. These are stocks. Okay. Notice, when you're investing in stock, the percentage of ownership in stock is very important. We have three classifications. If we own less than 20% of a company's stock, we're going to account for the investment under the fair value method. When we own between 20 and 50% of their stock, we use something called the equity method. And when we own more than 50% of a company's stock, we control the company. We would consolidate, use consolidation accounting. We are not going to talk about consolidation accounting in this video. That's an entire class in advanced accounting. Okay, but we will look at the first two methods. The good news here is, unlike debt securities, we only have one classification, and that is what we call fair value through net income, which, notice I put, is the same conceptually as trading securities for bonds, debt securities, okay? But we call it fair value through net income. Think of it as trading securities. Unrealized holding gains and losses are recognized in net income for each period. Okay? There used to be trading and available for sale. They decided to get rid of the available for sale classification and only use trading, but they changed the name to fair value through net income. All right, so we're going to look at the following transactions and their related journal entries. When we invest, when we receive dividends, we're going to do a fair value adjustment at the end of each period, and then when we sell the investment. And these are relatively straightforward journal entries. On April 1st, ABC invested $700,000 to acquire 10,000 shares in XYZ company. This is less than 20% ownership. Okay, so we use the fair value method. On September 1st, ABC paid a dividend of $4 per share. We own 10,000 shares. That'll be a $40,000 dividend. So the journal entries on the day of investment, we debit the investment, we credit cash. And when we receive the dividend, we debit cash and we credit dividend revenue. Very straightforward. On December 31st year end, the fair value increased to $72 per share. And then 3 days later, we sold the investment for a total of $750,000. So the investment was originally recorded at $700,000. At the end of the year, it's now worth $720,000. 10,000 times $72 per share, 720. So notice, we debit the fair value adjustment account, 20,000, and we credit the unrealized holding gain for net income for $20,000. That's going to hit the income statement. And when you hit the income statement, that means that the unrealized holding gain is going to get closed out. Okay, it's a closing entry. But the fair value adjustment account will sit on the balance sheet along with investments, and it shows that investments have increased in value since we made the initial investment. Okay, 3 days later, we sell the investment for $750,000. Debit cash, $750,000. Credit the investment account, $700,000. Credit the fair value adjustment account, $20,000. And we're going to recognize a $30,000 gain on sale in the following year. So we made a total gain of $750,000, but $20,000 of that gain was recognized in the previous period on December 31st, and then $30,000, the stock went up sharply in a short matter of time. We have a $30,000 gain in the new time period. Those are the journal entries. That's very straightforward for fair value accounting. Now, when we own more than 20%, but less than 50%, we don't have a controlling interest. Let's take a look at this slide, because there's some things that are going to arise relating to the equity method that we need to kind of recognize. Okay, we have a long-term relationship with this company. We can influence management. We have what's called significant influence over management. We probably have seats on the board of directors. Okay, so when the investment does well, our investment does well, we do well. Okay, and vice versa. Okay, when they have net income, then we're going to increase our investment by our percentage of ownership. Okay? If they lose money, we would decrease our investment by the same percentage of our ownership. And when they pay a dividend, it's kind of like conceptually when we pay a dividend. Think back to when a company pays a dividend. Okay? They're going to credit cash and they're going to debit the dividend account or retained earnings. Remember, dividends gets closed out to retained earnings. So a debit to retained earnings is a reduction, right? Cash, which is an asset, goes down. Retained earnings, which is equity, goes down. It's similar conceptually here. We're going to receive cash, right? We can get the dividend. However, we're going to reduce the value of our investment because the company is giving out money. It's shrinking, right? It's going down in value by the amount of the dividend. So we reduce our investment account when we receive a dividend under the equity method. Now, let's take a look at what's going on here. Okay, because this is going to have some ramifications in a little bit. ABC Company purchased 30% of XYZ Company for $750,000 cash. We now own 30% of their stock. Look at the balance sheet accounts on the general ledger of XYZ. That's the book value. The building, okay, which has a 10-year remaining life, no salvage value, $500,000. The land's $250,000. Other net assets, we'll say $300,000. Total net assets, $1,050,000. The fair value at the time we made the investment, you can see the building's $1,000,000. The land's $500,000. Other net assets, the same. Total fair value of net assets was $1,800,000. We paid the total fair value of the company, though, is $2.5 million, and when we acquired 30% of that, our investment cost us $750,000. Notice that the difference between the fair value of net assets, $1,800,000, and the total fair value of the company of $2.5 million implies goodwill of $700,000. So when we made the investment, it was based on the fair value of the entire company, 30% of $2.5 million, is how we came up with the $750,000 price tag for our investment. Okay, we're going to come back to that in a little bit. Okay, debit investment, $750,000, credit cash. There's the initial journal entry for the investment. XYZ had net income of $250,000 and they paid a $100,000 dividend. 30% of that would be ours, right? So we're going to increase our investment by 30% of the $250,000 net income. That's $75,000. We debit the investment, $75,000. And we credit investment revenue, $75,000. Notice it's not cash. We're recognizing our percentage of the acquired stock's net income, okay, by increasing our asset value of the investment and recognizing revenue for 30% of their net income. We also got a dividend of $30,000, which is 30% of $100,000. So we debit cash for the $30,000 we received, but notice we reduce the value of our investment by $30,000. Okay? You almost have to think of it as that this is almost like our company. We own a significant portion of it. And so when our company pays a dividend, cash goes down, the investment goes down. Okay, so we're saying, okay, we received cash, but our investment, the company is now a little bit smaller because they paid out this dividend, and so we're going to reduce our investment in XYZ by the amount of the dividend. Okay, so you may, like I said, hit pause, review it, think about it before going on, but under the equity method, when you have significant influence over management, you own between 20 and 50%, their net income will increase our investment, and when they pay a dividend, it decreases our investment. Let's take a look at these next two slides. They're very wordy, so we're going to kind of read through them together. And I want you to think about them. Hit pause anytime you need to, because this is complicated stuff. If ABC Company acquired more than 50% of XYZ's stock, ABC, which would be the parent company, would have a controlling interest in XYZ. XYZ is now called the subsidiary. ABC would use consolidation accounting, okay, which is a whole different area, which we're not going to talk about. Okay? And when they prepare financial statements, they combine or consolidate the two companies' financial statements into one set of consolidated financial statements. Before this is done, when the acquisition of more than 50% of the stock took place, ABC recognizes the fair value of all of XYZ's assets and liabilities. Okay? And remember, assets minus liabilities we call net assets. Okay? So we acquired more than 50% in this example, so we have to update all those accounts from the old book value to the current market value. Okay? This change will produce changes in other numbers such as depreciation and amortization expense, cost of goods sold, and other accounts. Think depreciation for a moment. If the company had an old book value that was, say, $50,000, and now, because of the acquisition, the fair value is now $80,000, when we depreciate the asset using the new fair value, that's going to create higher depreciation, right, than if you calculate depreciation based on the book value of $50,000. Okay? Now, this relates to what we do with the equity method of accounting. That's why we had to talk about this. When we invest in XYZ using the equity method, we only record the investment of XYZ in our records. We debit the investment account. We do not record accounts receivable, inventory, land, buildings, etc., and we don't record any liabilities for that matter. Okay? This investment is recorded in our records at the amount we paid, which was the fair value. Okay, and that's an amount higher than the book value of the net assets, which is consistent with consolidation accounting, and it's supposed to be. XYZ continues to run their business, and their general ledger maintains all of those asset liabilities at their book value. So they record depreciation and amortization expense and cost of goods sold based on their book values. These expenses that they're recording are lower than what we would record had we had to record depreciation amortization based on the fair value that we paid. So they're using book value to calculate depreciation, and their net income was based on their book value and the related depreciation. Okay, those numbers, those expenses are lower than what we would record considering our investment is at fair value. Okay, we're going to go back in a moment to look at that earlier slide to just kind of highlight the differences in the values. Okay, we're going to look at the difference between the book value and fair value. Okay, and a couple of things to point out. To keep things simple, we only made a couple of differences between book value and fair value. First, the building has a book value on XYZ's financial statement or financial records at $500,000. The fair value at the time we invested in them was $1 million. Very, very normal for real estate in particular to increase in value. Land had a book value of $250,000, had a fair value of $500,000 at the time we made the investment. And everything else we kept the same. Okay? So those numbers should look familiar, because that's just the same, it's the previous slide minus a few things. Now, land does not get depreciated. So the fact that there's a difference between book value and fair value doesn't have any impact on how we account for this investment because there's no depreciation. The building, however, is a different story. Notice the building has a 10-year remaining life, no salvage value, and will assume straight-line depreciation to keep life simple. XYZ would have recorded depreciation of $500,000 divided by 10 years. So that's $50,000 of depreciation for the year. Had they used $1 million, that would have resulted in $100,000 of depreciation. Note the difference between book value and fair value. When they calculated net income, they used $50,000 depreciation expense, and of course, our portion of that would have been the 30%. So the net income they reported was $250,000. We got 30% of that. We increased our investment by $75,000. Given that we're carrying this investment at fair value, we need to make an adjustment to those accounts that are being carried at fair value, but the income that we recorded from XYZ was calculated based on their book value. Okay? So the difference between the depreciation they recorded and what the depreciation would have been using fair value is $50,000. Our percentage of that would have been 30%, which is $15,000. And so the depreciation expense affecting us and our records would have been $15,000 higher had fair value been used. If the depreciation expense is $15,000 higher, then our portion of the net income would have been $15,000 lower. Okay? Again, had fair value been used, depreciation expense would have been $50,000 higher. Our 30% of that is $15,000. The higher the depreciation expense, the lower the net income. So our net income, which we use to increase our investment, should be less by $15,000. So notice what we do. We're going to credit the investment account by $15,000. And we're going to debit the investment revenue by $15,000. And that's going to take into account the difference between fair value and book value when calculating depreciation. This is probably the trickiest part of the entire equity method, is making these types of adjustments. Okay, because we recorded the investment at fair value. XYZ is determining net income based on their book value. Two different numbers. Okay? So take a good look at that. Here's what our account looks like when all is said and done. Okay, there's the original investment, debit $750. The $75,000 was our 30% of their net income. Remember, their net income was $250,000. 250 times 30%, 75. They paid a $100,000 dividend. We debited cash. We credited the investment account to reduce the investment by $30,000. And then the last entry is that depreciation adjustment of $15,000, which reduces our investment as well. Our year-end balance in the investment account is $780,000. Now, I'll just mention briefly that we would ignore fair value at year-end unless we chose to adopt the fair value option, which is available in a variety of scenarios. Okay, but we'll leave it at that. So that's investment in equity securities.